Welcome back to Fundamentals of Conflict Resolution and Peacebuilding. We are starting your course now that we've created a safe, supportive environment and have reviewed basic expectations, approaches. Hopefully you're well engaged with your workbooks at the moment and your text. We are starting our studies with nonviolence and non-cooperation, because it is one of those fundamental tools and processes that we have seen for many generations as oppressed people come together, empower themselves, and speak out against tyranny, injustice. We're seeing a lot of it today. All the protest movements that we're seeing right now with Black Lives Matter, with reproductive rights, with climate change, right? All of it, you're being introduced to some of nonviolent resistance. We have certainly seen nonviolent resistance against China with the Hong Kong Chinese. And we have seen nonviolent resistance in Belarus, Russia, amazingly, that takes such courage, Myanmar, different parts of the world where people are being held down by communist, dictatorial, oppressive regimes. I would like you to explore how you can make this a part of your daily, day-to-day lives by suggesting that each of you have the power to cooperate with only what you respect and hold true value for yourself, and you can say no to and refuse to cooperate when you're being asked to do something or think something or feel something that does not respect you, does not fit with your worldview and your values. Let me give you some practical examples. In my work, catalyzing and, first of all, let's start with my whistleblowing work of exposing abuse of children, fraud and deceit of religious leaders, and working with highly racist, sexist, homophobic community members. What I have seen in leading charges for social justice, improvement, and change is that we need each other. There needs to be a critical collective mass of people who have done their own, what I would call spiritual work, life work, in order to be on board with going forward, transforming a system and creating change in social justice. It rarely happens. I mean, it can happen in a courtroom with a lawsuit, but I'm talking about toxic systems and groups right now. Cultures, we need each other. We need to come together. And the protests that you see is just a small part of nonviolent resistance. The day-to-day decisions of what we purchase, do we boycott, you know, homophobic businesses or racist businesses or sexist businesses, those kind of day-to-day choices can be very powerful if enough of us are making those choices. And let's break it down to just a daily occurrence. I have been a safe ally for our LGBTQ plus students and for other students, all students, frankly, the whole two decades I've been at Dominguez. We all need allies. We all need power allies. We need people who support us and take our side when we are fighting against injustice and oppression. And looking for and finding those allies is a life adventure, right? But let's talk about bullying in your schools when you were in middle school, grade school, high school. Concerned bystanders can make all the difference. Somebody who speaks up, who speaks out against what the bully is doing, now you're like, why would I do that? I'd be attacked. No, I'm not giving you a formula for every situation. We all have to assess the risk of violence and, you know, harm wherever we are. But if enough concerned bystanders take on a bully, now, I'm not talking about warring gangs here, right? I'm not painting some fantasy image, but let's just talk about in your classroom. It can make a huge difference. I know when I spoke up and stood up for children being bullied on my playground, I was able to intimidate and deflect the bullying. That level of concern for each other needs to become more a part, along with assessment, real world assessment, you know, of risk. Yeah, my students say, well, what if somebody's armed? Yeah, I get the real world assessment of risk. We have to do it. But if we are doing that real world assessment of risk, and we have the opportunity to speak up and stand up for our values, we need to be doing that more and more. Because that collective mass is critical for our humanity, for our future as human beings. And that's some of what we'll be studying as you, you know, watch Gandhi and the story of how Indians came together to liberate themselves from the British colonization. You're going to be studying some of you watching the birth of the civil rights movement in this country. They actually, you know, Dr. King and his movement, they went to India. They were in love with what Gandhi did, and they were trying to study the strategy. You know, Cesar Chavez and the great boycott in California. As we look at this, we can be asking ourselves, okay, am I supporting what I believe in as powerfully as possible on a day-to-day basis with all the choices I make? And am I saying no to what I don't? That's power. Have a good week.